Okay, and I guess we'll see how this all works out. One thing I wanted just some quick bookkeeping to do here is I when I grade something, I leave comments in the rubric. And so let me show you what that looks like from the student view. So if you go to grades, and you can go here, I just made some stuff up on this one. And this little icon here, if you click it, it will show you the rubric. And I'll show you where the points were and if I left any comments. For example, here you lost a half a point because there was a problem with the constructors. So always, if you're wondering, well, why did I get that score? I will usually leave everything in the rubric there for you. So that's one thing I wanted to talk about. The other little bookkeeping thing that I wanted to talk about was these images that are still awful small. You know, how are you going to read that without a magnifying glass? Well, what you do is you right click and you can open the image in a new tab. I'm not sure how you do a right click on a Macintosh. I've never figured that out, but apparently there's a way to do it. And most browsers will let you open the image in a new tab, and then you'll be able to see it at least something close to full size, and then you'll be able to read what's going on. By the way, before I start, I know that probably nobody has had a chance to read the stuff that was supposed to be for a day because everybody's trying to avoid drowning in the flood over the weekend. So I'm not going to ask any questions as I would normally do, but let's just start off and talk about this. This is a UML diagram. We have something called a shape class, and we have a private X and Y, which tells where something is on the screen. So I have a getter and setter and for the X and Y. And for any shape, we would like to calculate its area and its perimeter. And we also want to convert it to a string. And then we're going to have a rectangle. A rectangle will not only have the X and Y, which it inherits, but it will also have a width and height. And it'll be able to calculate the area and perimeter. And for a circle, we have a radius as an extra property. And then again, it's going to need a getter and setter and calculate the area and perimeter. So everybody's okay with this idea? This is inheritance, and you talked about that last semester. So this is all very good. Let's go here to our shape class. And it has a double X and Y. And there's nothing particularly new here. X and Y could be negative, by the way. And then we can, the getter and setter, no big deal. Okay. Now, here's where we're going to run into problems. How do you calculate the area of a shape? That's sort of meaningless, right? If I say, okay, calculate the area of the shape, the first thing you ask me, well, which shape do you want, right? Okay. So a shape is really an abstraction. There are concrete things like squares and rectangles and triangles. But a shape is just sort of an abstract construct. So what we're going to be able to, in fact, if I try and do this, I could do something, you know, sneaky, like return zero. But that's really sort of ugly. I mean, it doesn't feel right. So there's a solution to this. When you have a class, and let's see if this compiles even. Yeah, it compiles like a champ. Good. What you can do is you can say, we're going to make this an abstract class shape. In fact, there's something I want to do here. Let's go to make a new folder, a new file here. Save this as, let's call this a, now here I have a public class example. And you know what I'm going to do right now before I go any further? because I get tired of typing this every damn time. What I'm going to do is I'm going to change this to say description of program goes here, and then I'll put my name and the date. And then usually I'm going to need a scanner for doing input. And here I will have a scanner input becomes new scanner system.in and then input.close. This is the stuff I'm going to have to do every time I write a program. So I'm going to go right now and I'm going to save this as template.java and rename it as template. Now I don't have to do that every single time I this. So I recommend that you create a template file for yourselves. It'll save you a lot of typing. Okay. There, I feel better now. Okay, so back here, an example, I could have a shape S becomes a new shape. And let's look at our constructor. It has to have an X and Y. So great, we're going to do a shape of 0.0, 0.0. And then let's do a system out.println of S. File that and run it. Great, it works like a champ. Okay, does what we want. But again, this is an abstraction. We're still stuck with this bad calc area and calc perimeter. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to make this an abstract class. And then instead of having to create a body for this method, I'm going to say this is also an abstract method, which means I'm not going to provide any implementation of it. If you extend this class, you have to do it yourselves. And similarly here, this is going to be an abstract method because I don't know how to calculate something for a generic shape. But if you implement something called a triangle, you'll provide that for me. Everybody okay with this so far? I don't know if, did you go through this last semester or not? Did they talk about this at all? I think some classes did and some didn't. Okay, so let's save this. And now it compiles. It still compiles like just fine. Now, what happens when I try and do this? If I compile it now, it'll say, shape is abstract. You cannot make an instance of an abstract class. And because there is no such thing as a generic shape. Now, let's look at our circle class. Our circle class extends shape. Notice it does not say it's abstract anymore. It has a radius and has all of this stuff here. Get radius, set radius. And now here we are going to provide the methods. And I've added another one here called calc circumference, which is the same as perimeter. The perimeter of a circle is called the circumference. So I said, yeah, let's add another method for that. Now look at my toString. Again, this is a remind you of what we did, the kind of things we did when we were doing parent classes and child classes. Here, I'm going to have a circle and I'm going to use super.toString. So I'm going to call the toString method from the super class, which is shape, which will give me the X and Y coordinates. That's what it does here. And then I will add in the radius. So here I can say circle C becomes a new circle that's, let's say, at 5.0, 3.5, and has a radius of 4.8. Now I can do this, and I can say double area becomes C dot calculate area. And everything is going to work here just fine as well. Oh, I better print it out, hadn't I? Well, that. And there are no errors this time. And there we have the circle is at this coordinate with that radius, and there's the area. There's nothing new here. The only thing that we have done that's new here is that we have implemented the abstract methods. Now, a rectangle is not in the book, it turns out. So here I have, again, a rectangle extends a shape. Oh, one thing I want to point out real quick here is at the beginning of the file, my comments tell what the x, y coordinates stand for. Why? Because you want to provide that for anybody who's going to be using these classes. And let's go back to rectangle. So here the x, y coordinates are the upper left corner. And then we know the length and the width. Now, if I were to try and compile this, you'll notice I have not provided the git calc area and calc perimeter here yet. What happens if I try and do that? Remember, it says, oh, rectangle is not abstract and does not override the abstract method calc perimeter. So it says, no, you can't do that. So you have to do that, otherwise it won't compile. So that's public double calc area. And anybody know what the body of that's going to look like? How do you get the area of a rectangle? Yeah. So I'm going to return. Here, let me move this down a little bit here. There's the names of our properties. So what should I return? Okay, I could say length times width. That's unambiguous. It also might be useful to say this dot length times this dot width to make it absolutely unambiguous that, yes, we are talking about the properties and not some other variable that happens to have that same name. And then we're also going to have our public double calc perimeter. And it's going to be returning 2 times this dot length plus this dot width. I'll give you that one for free. And now when we compile it, everything's great. We could also, by the way, put in this annotation. These are called an annotation to help the compiler. And this says we are explicitly overriding the one that exists in the superclass. And the reason you want to put that in is because if you accidentally type something wrong, it will tell you, no, your method signature is not correct. Do y'all remember method signatures? Anybody can tell me what a method signature is? Let me start some notes here. So method signature is the name and the number and type of its parameters. So if I have, for example, public static double calc stuff of int n double x string s. This part here is the signature. And I misspelled parameters. Let me spell that right. The method signature does not include the return type. So it's possible for me to have one method like this and another one and there's no conflict between these. the compiler will be able to figure it out when you call it by which parameters you give and how many there are. Well, let me change this. Let me turn off this. There we go. Let me save this here before I forget. And again, the override, if I had done something like this, calc area of, let's say, in N, and tried to compile it. Okay, it says, wait a minute, you haven't overridden calc area, and also you haven't overridden or implemented this from the supertype. There is nothing with an int N in the supertype. So that @ override annotation will help you find errors that might slip through otherwise. Let's compile this. So now I've got my rectangle and my circle. Let's go back here and let's have a rectangle. R becomes a new rectangle. God, spelling it right. And the X and Y are going to be, let's say, 1.5, 7.8. It's going to be 4 by 9. So then I can say, and by the way, this line is getting a little bit too long. I'm not going to let it wrap. I'm going to go down to the next line and indent. I'm going to have to add a blank and then perimeter plus r dot calc perimeter. Oh, what'd I do? Yes, I forgot to put in a closing parenthesis. And there that is. You'll notice, by the way, this is not the letter X. It turns out when you look at rectangle.java, and by the way, I'll upload all these files. I'm going to make a zip file with everything I do and upload it later on. You'll notice this thing here, /u00d7. What that means is that's a Unicode. Do y'all know about Unicode? Okay, great. For those of you who want to go and see some later, there's unicode.org. So basically, if I could type, it would help. Has a numeric value for every character in most human languages. So when I say /u00b1, okay, that is Unicode for base 16 value 00b1, which I think works out to 177 in decimal, but don't quote me. And by the way, when I write a hexadecimal constant, base 16, I'll usually presume it's 0x. Now, this is something interesting. I wrote another example to use these shapes. In fact, let me just go back to this example here. This is sort of interesting. Remember I said shape S is new shape. And it says, no, you can't do that. You can't instantiate a shape. Now, here's a question. What would happen if I tried to do something like this? Would that cause a compile error or not? Okay, I've got some votes for no. How many people think it will have a problem? How many people think it won't have a problem? How many people don't care? I don't know. Muslims don't care, but that's okay. The answer is this is valid to do. What is because here we are assigning a subclass object to a superclass variable. Anybody remember the name for that? Yep. This is called polymorphism. And it's perfectly legal. Now, here's the next question. Can I say system.out.println circle plus s.getArea? Oh, no, it's not getArea, it's calcArea. My bad. There. And the answer is yes, I can do that. Now, the question is S here is a shape, correct? So is it going to try and call the calc area method here that has no body, or is it going to call the one from circle, which does have a method body? Well, I know what we all hope it will do, right? And the answer is dynamic binding looks at the actual runtime type of an object. So call the, well, I'm going to just put this in quote marks, the correct method. Execute it. Fair enough, it works. I'm sort of reviewing some of the stuff earlier in the chapter with polymorphism and inheritance here. Now, here's another question. Since S has a circle assigned to it, now, what happens if I try that? And the answer is, I'm sorry, there is no calc circumference. The reason is at compile time, all the compiler knows is that S is a shape. And because shape does not have a calc circumference in it, it's going to say there's an error in there. So the question is, how do we get around that problem? And the answer is this. First of all, we have to make sure we really are working with a circle. If S is an instance of circle, then it's okay to calculate the circumference. And I'm gonna split this into two lines to make it easier. This is called a cast. So now that I know that I'm really looking at a circle here, I can cast S to a circle. It's okay for me to do that at runtime. And then because the compiler says, oh, you want me to treat this as a circle? Cool, I'll treat it as a circle. And it goes here and says, oh, perfect. I have that method right here and there won't be a compile error anymore. Yeah, I know. Forgot the closing brace. And now it compiles okay. Now let's run that. And voila, everything's working like a champ. Yeah. So everybody okay with abstraction? So here's the key point to take away from this is an abstract class has methods with headers only and no body. Anyone extending the class has to implement those methods or declare the subclass to also be abstract. So that's the key on this one. Now, the next thing that we want to talk about is, see if I can move this over to this side a little bit. I guess I can close that. Can I close this? Yes, right here, sir. Is interfaces. So let's go here and let's open this. So here I have a bicycle with an electric bicycle and a cargo bicycle, which are subclasses of that. And again, this is straight from the book. Yeah, so cargo bicycle will have a maximum load and a current load. An electric bicycle has a battery capacity and a current charge. Now, the question is, what if I wanted an electric cargo bicycle? And I'd like to be able to say something like, okay, we're going to have an electric cargo bicycle that extends both electric bicycle and cargo bicycle. That'd be pretty nice, wouldn't it? And here is what the diagram would look like. Yeah. Oh, let's make this a little bit larger here. So the electric cargo bicycle inherits from both of these. Well, we can't do that. Java does not allow this. It's called multiple inheritance, and that's in some language. I think, does C++ let you do multiple inheritance? Yeah, okay. Unfortunately, Java doesn't. Okay, actually, that's more of a religious, this is a religious issue. Okay, there are some problems that you can run into if you have multiple inheritance. So the people who designed Java said, we don't want you running into these problems, so we won't allow it. Well, that sort of kills our electric cargo bicycle, doesn't it? Answer, no, it does not kill our electric cargo bicycle. Because what we're going to do is we're going to use an interface. And it's like an abstract class, except that all it has is methods. It just method headers. It does not have any properties, and it doesn't have any implemented methods. That last is not exactly true, by the way. You can use something called a default method, but I don't want to talk about that. For what we're doing here, an interface is like an abstract method, except everything in it is abstract, and you don't have to say the word abstract. Because it's an interface, that's just its nature. So we're going to have an interface called Electrified, and anybody who is going to implement a subclass using this is going to have to implement all three of these methods. Namely, get the charge capacity, get the current charge, and set the current charge. So here we have our bicycle class. Let me see if I've got them here. So here's the bicycle class. And now what we're going to do is we're going to have Electrified, which is an interface that has these three methods. And let me see if I have this here. Well, curse me, I did not copy that in. Okay, let me copy it so that you can read it a little bit better. So here's what our electric bicycle class is going to look like. Am I spelling this right? No. So it's an electric bicycle will extend a regular bicycle. That means that it's going to have a frame size, a number of gears, and the gear that you're currently in. Here, we're going to have to put in the charge capacity and current charge ourselves because they can't belong into the interface. And then we're going to implement Electrified, which means we have to create all three of these. And these are the methods that were in the interface. So again, it's like abstract, except it's all abstract. Okay, well, how does this improve matters? The reason this improves matters is now I can give my electric cargo bicycle. Because it can extend cargo bicycle and it will implement electrified. And let's put this in here. I don't know what, let me escape here. I need to know what the name of the class is before I save it. So it's going to extend the cargo bicycle and it will implement electrified so I can have. And the nice thing about this electrified is that anything that is electrified, I could have a blender that implements electrified, and then I'd have an electrified blender. Now, the next question is, okay, what does the UML diagram look like? And here's what the UML diagram looks like. We have these arrows that are solid that say this is a subclass. And the dotted arrow means that it's implementing an interface. Notice, by the way, that the interface is in italics. Okay, and the reason it's in italics is because it's an interface. Also, abstract classes are also going to be in italics. So here I have my electric cargo bicycle, which gets everything from cargo bicycle and also implements electrified. And there's my solution to multiple inheritance. I can implement as many interfaces as I want. I just can only inherit, I can only extend one class. Yeah. So, and I think I know who that fellow is here. It's a, I hope that's Jeff. Yes. Okay. No, I haven't taken roll yet. I'm going to do that now. And then I'm going to, I don't think I'm going to do this on Wednesday because everybody's been here all the time. So I think it's, I'll do the census a little later on, maybe tomorrow. Okay. Adan Farah. Thank you. Manat Gill. Thanks. Hold on, let me stop recording this. This does not need to be recorded. Let's see if cargo bicycle is anywhere here. Oh, I never implemented it. Okay, so it's not in the book. So if any of you were trying to do this in the book, oops, you never weren't able to get it. So there's something you might want to do. You might want to just, if you want some practice working with inheritance, you might want to implement cargo bicycle. Should we do that right now real quick? Okay, let's see. What does the cargo bicycle have anyway? I got to go back and look at my image in new tab. Okay, cargo bicycle has a max load and current load. Lovely. All right. So that means we're going to have to go to bicycle here. And you know what I'm going to do? I'm just going to save this under a different name. Let's call it cargobicycle.java. And so how do I say it's a subclass of bicycle? What's the keyword I need to put in here? Extends bicycle. And it's going to have a private max load and a private double current load. And then I'm going to have a, it has a double frame size, number of gears, and it's going to have a maximum load. By the way, it'd be really nice to have this here. That would be really useful for somebody who's using this class to know. Now, if I try to do something like this, if I try and compile this, it's going to say, no, you can't set the frame size because that has private access. Yeah. Now, what if I say something like set frame size to frame size? Aha, because that should be, let's see what happens then. And the answer is, there isn't one. Why? Because when you have a bicycle and you construct one, oh, let me open up my bicycle again. There's a get frame size, but there's no set frame size. And once the frame size is established, you can't change the size of your bicycle frame. You can certainly change the, you can't even set the number of gears. You can set what your current gear is, but you can't change how many gears your bicycle has, right? Well, dang, we're stuck on this, aren't we, with our cargo bicycle? Answer is, how are we going to get around this and set the frame size and number of gears if there's no such method? Anybody remember how to get around this little problem? Really super solution for it. We call the superclass constructor and give it frame size and the number of gears. And then we'll set our maximum load to be whatever you told me it was. And since we have this current load, when you get a new bicycle shipped, we're going to say current load becomes 0.0. Okay. Let's get rid of this junk here. Let's compile it. Oh, I don't have the set max load yet. Okay, well, time to implement that, isn't it? Okay, so we're going to have a public double get max load, which will return this dot max load. And we're going to have a public void set the maximum load to some double that you're going to give me. And we're going to say this dot maximum load becomes the absolute value of whatever you give me. That way, in some case, somebody decides to be funny with us and give us a negative number, we won't have negative cargo. And then similarly, oh, wait a minute, we can't set the maximum load. Once it's established, we never want to change it, right? That's part of a bicycle that can't change. Okay, well, that goes away. But the current load, aha, that we need to be able to both get and set. So what we're going to do here is a public double get current load. And we're going to return this dot current load. And then we're going to have a public void set the current load to some new value. And then we're going to say if current load, well, okay. Man, this is ugly, okay? What I want to do is I want to make sure it's greater than zero, greater than or equal to zero, and also less than or equal to the maximum load. Okay? So it's definitely going to have to be the maximum dot maximum of zero. So if you give me a negative number, that means zero is going to be bigger than that number, right? And then I want math dot min of current load and max load. So whichever one of those is smaller, that's going to become our current load. I could do it with a bunch of if statements. Frankly, the if statement would probably be easier to read than this, but I just sort of wanted to give myself a little challenge there. Do you want me to rewrite it with if statements instead? Okay, well, let me do this. I want to keep this here, so let's... Let's rewrite this here. I'll comment it out later. So this means here, if the current load less than zero, then this dot current load becomes zero. Otherwise, if the current load is greater than the maximum available, then we'll set it to the maximum. Otherwise, it must be between them. And we'll set it to whatever you gave me. I think that's morally equivalent to what I wrote earlier. I haven't thought it through carefully. I'm writing this as I'm thinking about it, which is not a good idea, but that's what happens when you're doing performance art. Sir. And that's, by the way, there are no two strings anywhere here. I didn't write a two string method for any of these. So I'll upload all of this stuff. If you feel ambitious and you want to put in some two string business, that I'd go, oh my goodness. Okay. Fine. That's right, because there is no setter. Once you do it, it's done forever. Okay, now that I've got a cargo bicycle, now let's see if I can compile an electric cargo bicycle. Yay, it compiled fine. I'm so, you have no idea how happy I am to see that. Okay, that having been done, it is time to look at great. The assignments that are there are two assignments that have to do with abstract classes and interfaces. Now, what I'm going to do on Wednesday, by the way, I'm going to talk about generics for a few minutes. It's a fairly short topic. And then I'm going to circle back to chapter one and talk about collections. Because every time we're talking about collections of data, like lists, or any of y'all ever program in Python? Okay, there's something called a dictionary, also called a hash map or a hash table. And there's all sorts of different collections of data that Java implements. And they're all going to use these generic things. I didn't talk about them last week because I ran out of time. And B, I figured after, you know, why am I talking about all these things with generics if you haven't studied generics? So that's what's on for Wednesday. Abstract classes. So I'm giving you a file to start with. You'll save it as testequations.java. And it'll have an abstract class for equations. Equations with one variable called equation. And this abstract class is going to have a find solution method. That's an abstract method because there's lots of kinds of equations, aren't there? And there are two subclasses that you're going to have here. Oh, well, that was exciting. Let's close that tab. Okay, it doesn't let me do that. Canvas is weird. What can I say? But you can save the image and look at it later. Look at it in a larger size yourselves. And here's a linear equation, which is a subclass of equation, and quadratic equation, which is an equation in one variable. And you'll notice they both have a find solution method because they have to, and oh, look, there's the italics. There's my abstract class and there's the abstract method. I know it's an abstract public method because it has the plus sign. I know it's abstract because it's in italics. So for a linear equation, you have an array of coefficients, or you can give it an A and B for AX plus B equals zero. And then you're going to have to implement the find solution. And you want to have a two-string method that returns a string in a nice printable form. Then quadratic equation, you can either set it up with an array of three coefficients, or you can give it three doubles for A, B, and C, AX squared plus BX plus C equals zero. And I hope everybody remembers the quadratic equation. If you don't, look it up. Find solution will return null if there's no solutions, an array of length one if there's only one root, and an array of length two. So that one's a little bit trickier to write. And then you want a toString method that will return ax squared plus bx plus c equals zero. And here is the Unicode value to use for a superscript two. And again, here's your starting point. Let's take a look and see if it'll come up here within our lifetime. So here's my abstract class equation, which has an array of coefficients. If you set up an equation with nothing, then it's a null entry. If you give it coefficients, then fine. That's what it becomes. And then here's our public abstract double find solution. And then here's your linear equation code and your quadratic equation code. And here is a program that will help you test it. So you'll be inserting the code where it says to insert the code. So that's part one. That's the abstract classes assignment. Excuse me. What was that? And then interfaces. Yeah. I've got three classes that I provide you with: time of day and location. So time of day has an hour and minute. Location has a latitude and longitude by degrees and minutes. In fact, may as well take a look at it. Couldn't hurt. See, this is the one where it takes forever to come back. Okay. Tell you what, let's just... So I'm going to need Java util arrays. And here's time of day, which has an hour and minute. And it has its constructors and getters and setters. And I also even gave you a toString method. I'm so nice. And then there's a location, which has the latitude degrees in minutes and longitude degrees in minutes. Has two different constructors. And then I have a private method here because sometimes I want to be able to clamp a value between a minimum and maximum value. With latitude and longitude, I have to be able to go between, like the minutes has to be between 0 and 59, and the degrees has to be between negative 180 and positive 180 or negative 90 and positive 90. So this is going to be a helper method. All of this has been implemented for you. You do not have to change any of those particular classes. Yeah. Boy, was this ever a pain to do. But the output is gorgeous. Yeah, so. And then here's the test where you will create a time of day and a location object, and it will call the to number and from number method, which I haven't talked about. Okay, so now I've got these classes. And the question is, what would I like to do is represent both of these types of data by a single integer. Okay, now that's a ridiculous thing to do, but I needed something, all right? Actually, it's not that silly as it may sound. We're going to eventually get something called a hash code, and that's where you do get an integer based on some value. So there's the numerify interface, and that's already provided for you up here. So your time of day is going to have to implement numerify, which means it's going to have a to number and a from number method. You're going to have to do that for time of day. When you have a to number, it will take a time of day and provide you back with one unique number for any time of day. And from number, number, if you give it that unique number, it'll give you back the hour and minute. In fact, there we go. It says right there. So you're going to have to implement those two methods in the time of day and location. So how do you convert a time of day to a single number? Here's one way to do it. There may be some other way, but this was the easiest way, is multiply the hour by 60 and add the minute. Guaranteed it's going to be a unique number for every time of day. And then to convert a number into an hour and minute, returned as an array of integers, you divide by 60 and mod 60. And that splits your unique number back into the original parts. For location, that's a little bit trickier. Okay, because of negative latitudes and longitudes. And this is the first one that came to my mind of how to do it. It says right here, there may be other better ways to do a conversion of a latitude and longitude into a single number. And if you find a better way or something that's, you know, easier to understand, go ahead and use it. So here's what it should look like. For example, 818 comes out to 498. And when I take 498, that splits it into an array, 8 and 18. Okay, if I have this latitude and longitude, it comes up with this number. And when I do the from number, it'll split it into the degrees and minutes for the latitude and the longitude. This one is a little bit trickier to do. The actual interface part, making it make sure that it uses an interface, is like two or three lines. So to make sure that everything implements the interface, that's not a lot of the code. Most of the code is going to be actually implementing those methods in the subclasses. And I'm running 5 minutes over time. But that should about do it for this. And again, Wednesday, I'll talk about generics and circle back to collections. And let me stop recording.